Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. My beloved brothers and sisters, Allah created us, humankind, in this world, and after this He has a hereafter. We will all go to the hereafter. There is no way that you are going to escape the hereafter. The wisest of us is the one who prepares for the day that we're going to go back to Allah. What does He have in store for us? If I were to ask you, you would say, Jannah, right? You need to have hope that Allah will give you Jannah through His mercy. You're a good person. May Allah grant us goodness. Why do I say you're a good person? You believe in Allah. You try your best. You engage in istighfar and seek forgiveness where you've gone wrong. And you continue to try to worship Allah in the best possible way, and you discipline yourself, and when you do something bad, you feel bad, and when you do something good, you feel good. That's what a believer is all about. Adam alayhi salam made a mistake or committed a sin. He felt bad. He sought the forgiveness of Allah. What did Allah do? He is also going to be in Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah grant us Jannah. But my brothers and sisters, Allah created us in this world with certain things that He has placed in order to test us. Two of them I want to mention today. Khawf and huzn. Fear and sadness. When you come onto the earth, Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. Subhanallah. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah says, we will definitely indeed test all of you with a little bit of fear. Fear. That's the first thing Allah speaks about. Fear is your first test. And that's why when Allah speaks of Jannah, always He says, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ. There's going to be no fear. They will not need to fear. There's not going to be any sense of fear. What is fear? It might be a small word, but in the English language, many words would be needed to translate the Arabic khawf. For example, anxiety is khawf. When a person is worried about the future, worry is also a type of khawf. When a person doesn't know what's going to happen tomorrow, that's also khawf. When a person is in real fear or is scared, that is khawf. All this is going to happen on earth. You have people who threaten you. You have a job you might lose. You might have lost in terms of your health. You're worried about your children, the future, what's going to happen. All that is normal. Allah says, we made you on earth in order to test you with khawf. That's one thing. Second thing is huzn. Huzn is sadness. When Allah describes Jannah, He always says, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. They will have no reason to fear, to be sad or to fear either one of them. Why does Allah say, no fear, no sadness? Because it proves that in this world, there will be fear and there will be sadness. That's what it is. Sad about what? Sad because someone you didn't expect to do something to you, did that thing to you. You're sad. For example, things didn't go your way, you're sad. Well, I'm going to tell you something shortly. When Allah Almighty is worshipped alone and you understand He is in charge, your sadness goes away. Because you know, Allah did it, there must be some khair in this. There must be some goodness in this. I lost everything, there is goodness. I lost a limb, there is goodness. I lost my life, there is goodness. Allah wanted you to die at a certain point, the age of 26. For example, you're gone. That's not a bad thing. People who are left behind might think it's a bad thing. For as long as you got Jannah, Rabbi Halbaya, the deal was profitable. Subhanallah. If Allah says, I take you away now, but I give you Jannah, go. It's worth the deal. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us ease. It's easy to say it, right? Wait until someone comes and says, let's go. It's not going to happen that way. But when Malakul Maut comes, when the angel of death comes, you can't tell him, 2 minutes, I'm coming. No, not at all. So khawf and huzn, these are two things. Like I said, Allah tells us in Jannah, there's no khawf, no huzn. There is no fear, there is no sadness. In this world, there will be fear and sadness. But when you worship Allah, Allah will take away sadness and worry, fear, even in this world. فَمَن تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. The term khawf and huzun have been repeated together 14 times in the Quran. Most of them, or six of them, are in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah says, if you follow the guidance we sent you, there will be no element of fear, no element of sadness. Wow. Why? Because why should I worry? I laid my trust in Allah totally. I tried my best. I'm a good person. I worship Allah. I don't maltreat people. I don't cheat and deceive. I don't backstab people. Today, the backstabbing on earth is such that it will create fear in you. When you backstab someone and you harm someone thinking it will benefit you, in actual fact, it will create khawf and huzun in you, long term and short term. Remember this. If you are suffering with fear and sadness, something is wrong in either your relationship with Allah or how you have treated the fellow creatures of Allah. That's what it is. Something is wrong. Because if you're a true believer and you treat people well and you talk to them nicely and you respect everyone and you don't shortchange someone, you haven't cheated or deceived or backstabbed someone, etc., etc., there is no chance that you can go beyond a certain level or the minimum of al-khawf wal-huzun, fear and sadness. Obviously, minimum level as a human being, it's there. But you won't go beyond. You will lay your trust in Allah. If Allah did this, He did it. A person's whole factory burnt down and he says, Alhamdulillahi ala kulli hal. What's that? That's his iman. He says, you know what? I suffered a loss. Yes. But I know I'm a good person. Allah will grant me a recompense. If not in the dunya, then in the akhirah. And if I'm fortunate, then both in the dunya and in the akhirah. Allah will give you. How much do you want on earth? How many millions do you want to make on earth? You've already made so much. Do you really need it? The answer is no, you don't need it. It's just extra and excess. I like to ask the children, and I've asked them, how much money do you want to make in your life? Now in Zimbabwe, the figure has spiraled because obviously the zeros mean nothing anymore. But before, when money was money, they would say, I just want to make a million, then I can retire. I promise you, some of the adults will tell you, we made the first million, we went for the next one. We went the next one, we went for the 10. We made the 10, we wanted to go and go and go, and it does not stop. And how much are you going to use on earth? I promise you, not more than a few dollars. That's it. After that, your children, your family members will fight over that money when you're gone. Your brothers, stop speaking to each other only because of money, nothing else. Throw the money away and have your mahabba, have your love. It's better for you. May Allah grant us goodness. Throw your money away. You don't need it. Love is more important. Your relationship with your brother is far more important than that money. But you don't realize. If I were to ask you, put a value, put a price tag upon the money. Sorry, upon the relationship you have. You cannot. You want happiness. How much are you going to pay for happiness? I want to give you another example. People fear. What did I say earlier? Fear and sadness. Right? That's the topic today. Fear and sadness. How? In the Jannah, it's not going to be there. On earth, it is there. But if you have a relation with Allah, Allah minimizes it to a bare minimum. لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. Good relationship with Allah. Why should I fear? I lay my trust in Allah. So you have, subhanallah, a person, what would he pay for one heartbeat? One heartbeat. When your heart starts pumping a bit too fast or a bit too slow, what do? Spend money to go where? Doctor, specialist, fly off to somewhere, university, in wherever. You fly off here, medical, this, that. If you've got a lot of money, you'll end up in the top hospital in the world. You know why? You don't want that heart to stop for one beat. Allahu Akbar. And you spent 100 million. Why? One heartbeat. Agree? Allah tells you, lay your trust in me. It's okay. You'll be calm, cool. You do your salah. Imagine, you're so excited because Allah gave you the chance to put your head on the ground for Him. Did you know Allah chooses who He wills to put their heads on the ground for Him? It's not easy. Yes, you make an effort, but Allah either accepts that effort or rejects it. So many people live right next door to the masjid. You'll never see them there. And so many people live far away, they'll drive all the way there. Subhanallah. So many people live in Makkah, they haven't seen the haram inside. They've never been for Hajj. And there are others who live in Indonesia, and they are gone for Hajj every so often. Or at least their dream is one day we're going to go there. That's Allah. Allah accepts and rejects. رب العزة والجلال. So how do I protect myself from خوف and حزن? How do I protect myself from what Allah said He's going to test us with? Now the sadness comes because you lost a child. It's normal sadness. The sadness comes because you lost something. True sadness should be when you've missed your obligation up unto Allah. When you missed your obligation unto Allah, you missed Fajr, you should be very sad that day. Something went wrong, you committed a sin, you should be sad that day. That is true sadness. Why? Let me seek the forgiveness of Allah. And then you should be happy that Allah showed you a door to come out of the sadness by seeking forgiveness. Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. My brothers and sisters, how should I minimize this? Allah teaches it to you. 14 times in the Quran, He has told us these qualities of these people. If they do good and they worship me and they believe in the last day, they have no reason to fear nor to be sad. Leave it in my hands. And trust me, that's it. If you have tawakkul in Allah, you won't have a problem. What is tawakkul? To lay your trust in Allah and to leave things in the hands of Allah after you did what Allah gave you in terms of capacity to achieve what is right. Let me give you a quick example. People say, hey, there is a virus. Nothing will happen to you except by the will of Allah. We agree. Nothing can ever happen except by the will of Allah. We agree. But when Allah has given you the understanding and the capacity to do some form of precaution, some minimum form of protecting yourself, you need to do that. You need to do that because that part, Allah left it in your hands. Then you lay your trust in Allah. When you have a false trust in Allah, you say, Allah, nothing will happen except by your hands. I'm just going to carry on as though there is no lion in front of me. If the lion will bite, it will bite. If it won't bite, it won't bite. And guess what? Subhanallah, you're bitten and eaten. That is suicide. Because why did you throw yourself when Allah says, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ Don't throw yourselves with your own hands into destruction and death. That's what Allah says. So, I will be in my car, I will close my windows when I'm going to the lion park and I will make sure I don't misbehave. Then if the lion tears open that roof and mauls the person and eats them up, don't worry. That was always in the taqdeer of Allah in a way that you won't be questioned about it. You played your role and Allah did the rest. But when you did not play your role, then you have to answer to Allah, why did you pretend like you were a wise crack? That's the word. Wise crack. He thinks he's too sharp, too intelligent. He's the only one who trusts Allah. Not at all. You actually do not trust Allah. Why don't you sit at home and wait for the money to come in? People will come and say, oh, by the way, here's your salary. What work did you do? Where did you go? What happened? Nothing. You got up and you did work. So Allah says He will alleviate for you your fear and your sadness if you believe in Allah. I don't have the time to go through all these 14 verses, but I want to tell you, nearly all of them have mentioned in them of worshipping Allah, doing good deeds, and believing in the last day. I just give you one example. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ هَادُوا وَالنَّصَارَى etc. etc. The believers, the mu'mineen, those who were Jewish, those who were Christian, etc. etc. مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ Whoever believed in Allah and the last day, وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا and did good deeds, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ There will be no fear for them, nor will they have any reason to be sad because they believed in Allah and the last day and they did good deeds. Those are the three things you need. When you do those three, even in this world, Allah will help you so that your sadness comes down and Allah will help you so that your fear is alleviated. You can walk and you know nothing will harm me except if Allah has written it for me. May Allah bless every one of us. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.